So how have people tried to assess intelligence? What is intelligence actually made up of? The first systematic attempt to assess intelligence was in France, when the Education Board decided they needed to do something about children who are struggling in school. Now, a lot of history books portrayed this movement as an attempt by the French Education Board to try and help children who were struggling by giving them extra help so they could keep up with the rest of the class. However, there's reasonable evidence suggesting that actually what they were trying to do was kick the struggling children out of school so that they didn't detract from the schooling of the other children who were capable of being educated. So intelligence tests didn't have a particularly positive start. Alfred Binet and Theodore Simon were two French academics who were interested in measuring children's intelligence. They wrote test items for children to answer back in the early 1900s. This is known as the Binet-Simon scale. Binet and Simon wrote the test items for different age groups and then standardised the items across age groups with a sample of children. So for example, if a set of questions were standardised for 7-year-olds, all children aged 7 would have been able to answer those questions. If another set of questions were standardised for 8-year-old children, all children who were aged 8 would have been able to answer those questions. From the test results, the children were then assigned a mental age based on the age-normed items they were able to pass. That's not a number that we call IQ, it's just a number representing the child's mental age. Later on, an American psychologist, Lewis Terman, was interested in measuring intelligence. He saw what Binet and Simon were doing in France with their measure and decided to take that measure and adapt it to the American context. Terman translated Binet and Simon's intelligence measure into English and re-standardised the questions. He introduced the concept of IQ, which was the ratio of a child's mental age to their chronological age. IQ stands for intelligence quotient. His scale was called the Stanford-Binet scale because Terman worked at the Stanford Graduate School of Education. For example, if a 7-year-old child passed all the age 7 normed items, they would score a mental age of 7. To work out their IQ, according to the Stanford-Binet scale, we'd divide their mental age of 7 by their chronological age, which is also 7, and multiply it by 100. In this example, this 7-year-old child would score an IQ of 100. An IQ of 100 means this child is performing at the expected level for their age. If a 7-year-old child was able to answer all the 14-year-old normed questions, it would mean they would have an IQ of 200. The problem with the Stanford-Binet scale is that the age-normed items really only go up to 16 years of age, but chronological age keeps rising. What happens is if you give a person with an IQ of 100 this test every year and graphed how they scored, the measured mental age would increase in lockstep with their chronological age, and they would have an IQ of 100 at each time we measured it because their mental age would match their chronological age. So the IQ stays the same. However, when they hit 16 years of age, the measured IQ would actually start decreasing. Because their chronological age increases, their measured mental age is at the top of the scale, and so that doesn't keep up with their chronological age anymore. This is purely a function of the maths for calculating IQ this way. It's not that people become less intelligent in their teenage years, despite what their parents might say. It's just because the scale doesn't have any items beyond the age 16. This way of calculating IQ fell out of favour over time because it wasn't really adaptable to broader age groups. Today, when we measure IQ, we're not talking about the ratio of chronological age to mental age. What we do is we compare performance on an IQ test to the standardised data we have about performance on that test. If someone scored 115 on an IQ test, that's one standard deviation above the mean. IQ scores by definition have a mean of 100 and a standard deviation of 15. Over time, because people's average performance on the test gradually increases, we have to re-standardise the test so that the average is always back to 100. This is how we work out IQ tests now. It's literally on the basis of the standard normal curve.